Welcome to Recipes from Grandma's Kitchen. Traditional food and folk memories are important to the history and culture of the Germans from Russia. Recipes from Grandma's Kitchen provides a way to keep the traditions alive with step-by-step cooking instructions for some favorite Germans from Russia dishes. You'll learn how to prepare Schupfnoodla, strudel with chicken, Kuchen, and a special Christmas tea ring. But first, let's journey to the kitchen of Millie Hauck for a hearty pheasant soup with dumplings.
I'm Millie Hauck from Richardton, North Dakota. We have a farm ranch out here, and Adam and I had 7 children. We have 4 sons, and now we have 11 grandsons that just love to hunt, and we have abundance of pheasants out here. So over the years, I have developed this recipe that's called Pheasant Paprikash. It'll have meat in it and potatoes and carrots and dumplings over the top, and it's really a one-pot meal, and they've enjoyed it for the years. And no matter when they come back to hunt, after their first day of hunting, they clean their pheasants and bring them to me, so I fix them this meal for the next day. I have the pheasant, which is already washed and cleaned, and I'm going to be adding to that then the potatoes and carrots. And first of all, I'm going to start with some olive oil, which I'm going to be adding to my Dutch oven roaster here. Then that's a tablespoon of that. And then a tablespoon of paprika. And then about a cup of onions. And I'm gonna saute this. This pot here was a wedding gift that I had gotten 50 some years ago. And I swear I've used it practically every single day for cooking because it's so versatile. You can make so many different meals in it. It'll a lot of times have beef roast in it or pork roast, which will be in the oven, and it just really, the food really comes out nice out of this. This is about a pheasant and a half that I have here. And one thing about our hunters, they're very good at bringing you some really nice clean birds because they know I don't like to take too many feathers out of the meat. So we keep stirring this, and to this I'm going to add some pepper, which I do it this way. And just add about a good teaspoon of pepper, and then 2 teaspoons of salt. And this kind of is my measuring deal that I've always used over the years. Just put it into my hand and do that. Being I have the pheasant in the bottom with the onions and stuff, it'll be the first thing to saute. And I will cook this at least about an hour longer before I add the potatoes. I'm going to take the lid off of this. It's really boiling. And I'm going to be finishing off my pheasant paprikash here. So I'm going to add 2 tablespoons of chicken bouillon to it. And then I have 3 medium potatoes ready here and 2 carrots, which I'm going to add to this all now with the water. And this will have to boil about 20 minutes until the potatoes and the vegetables are tender. But it looks like it's coming along very nicely. After this, we'll have to make the dumplings to put over the top of all of this meat and potatoes. Now I'm going to make the dumplings for the pheasant paprikash. It takes 2 eggs, and I'm doubling the recipe because my family likes dumplings better than anything else in this dish. And then to that, I'm going to add 1 cup of flour to each bowl. Level them off. And then a teaspoon of salt to each. And now I'm going to mix this a little bit with the beater, and then we use a spoon. This is a job I usually hand on to somebody else to keep mixing this until it's real smooth and it follows the spoon around the inside of the dish. Okay, now I have this pheasant paprikash boiling, and now it's time to add the dumplings to it. This time I'm going to have my husband Adam help me because this is a little tricky and it takes time to do it because you only take a tip of a teaspoon of the dough and you put it into the boiling broth that we have here in this pheasant paprikash. Dip the spoon in each time because otherwise your dough won't slide off. And this is that mixture that we made with 2 eggs, 1 cup of flour, and a teaspoon of salt. And then we put them back onto the heat to boil them, and you cover them with the cover. You cover the kettle up with the cover, and they get real nice and fluffy and all come to the top when they're finished boiling. So, bit by bit, you finally get it all in there. And we'll put it back on and bring it to a good boil, and it's ready in about 10 minutes. Okay, these have been boiling, and so there's the dumplings. They puff up pretty nice for the little bit of dough you put in to the boiling broth. I leave the bone on the pheasant for the simple reason it gives it a whole lot more flavor. This whole dish now is ready to go to the table.
A special pot, this one handed down from her grandma, is also important to Erica Wangler, as she uses food preparation as one way to stay connected to her Germans from Russia roots.
Hello, my name is Erica Lang Wangler. I live in Bismarck. I was born in Napoleon, North Dakota. I grew up on a farmstead there. And today I'd like to cook Schupfnoodla, and in some dialects it was called Schupfnoodla. And what it is a meat, potato and dough dish. It's a stovetop type of hot dish that was cooked mostly on bread making day. The first step in making this dish is to take either oil or butter, and you'll want to use about 4 tablespoons. Since I already have prepared the chicken and browned it ahead of time, I will just tell you that you would put the butter in the pan, and then you would take it to the stove and turn it onto a medium heat and let the pan warm up really well so that you can brown the meat. Now this recipe, you'll want to use approximately 6 to 7 pieces of this brown chicken. And I will also add the liquid that I browned it with. And then you'll want to add some onion for flavor and spices. I'm going to be taking about a half a cup to 1 cup of onion, depending on how much onion you like in your dishes. We like a lot of onion. We always had onion at home. We grew it in the garden. And then you'll want to spread your pepper flavoring over it, about a teaspoon. And then you'll take salt and sprinkle that on top too, about a teaspoon. And then we'll take a little bit of parsley. I like to add a little parsley for color and some flavor. We will then add some liquid because this dish is mostly meant for steaming. So you have to always have an adequate amount of liquid so that it does stay moist. And I'll add 1 cup of water for right now. You'll want probably about 1/2 inch of water to 1 inch of water on the bottom of the pan. Next, we will take the potatoes and put them over the top. These are about 6 to 7 medium-sized potatoes that I've peeled and diced. And we'll just put those on top. And this is kind of like a layer type of dish. So you put those on top, and then at this stage, the potatoes and the meat will be taken to the stove and will be cooked for steaming it on medium heat, low to medium heat, for about 30 minutes until the meat and the potatoes are thoroughly cooked. You'll want to watch what's going on over at the stove, because we've started the hot dish part of it on medium heat, and you want to make sure that there's always enough moisture in there for stewing the meat and the potatoes. So I will be checking on that once in a while. But for right now, we're going to making the Schupfnoodla. What I do is take this dough and lightly flour the surface that I'm working on. This is just so the dough won't stick and it'll be much easier to work with. And I just kind of flatten it out at first and flour the surfaces so that it doesn't stick to the counter. Now the goal of rolling this is to roll it out to about 12 to 16 inches long, which would be about the size of a log and diameter of making like cinnamon rolls. And we just keep rolling it out until we've got a nice little log here. And from this roll, we will be cutting our Schupfnoodla, which really means dumplings. At this point now, we are ready to cut the dumplings. You need to prepare a cookie sheet and just lightly dust the cookie sheet so again that the dumplings don't stick to the pan. And a good measurement for cutting these is to cut them in lengths about the size of a finger, actually. And then if they're sticking, you'll want to dust them a little bit with flour. But this one isn't right at this time, so I'm just going to arrange this in the pan. And I'm dusting them as I go, just a bit. And you'll want to place them on the pan probably about 2 inches apart, because they need some room to expand when you let the dough rise. This has to rise again. We have to let the dough rise again for about 20 minutes to a half an hour, but you need to let them rise until they are about double of what they are at this point. Now, I remember my grandmother baking and cooking in her summer kitchen. They called it the Sommerküche. And their process took a little bit longer than what we're fortunate enough to have in this modern day. Grandma cooked in the summer kitchen because it wasn't as, you know, it was more open and airy, and you didn't have to heat up the whole house in those days for the summer so you could sleep at night. So they cooked out in this special building that was usually a few hundred feet from the house, the main living space. And they had their stove, and they did a lot of their washing of their clothes in there too, for the same reasons. They didn't want to heat up the whole house in the summertime. And Grandma had one of the old cook stoves. She used wood, but mostly she had us sometimes help her gather the cow chips from out in the pasture that were dried. If she was baking something that day or washing clothes to heat the water and to heat the stove, she would have us go out and gather some of the chips, and she would start the fire and she'd bake and wash clothes. I remember her asking me to do that. It's quite a different way of cooking from what we know today. Okay, I think we have as many as we need for our recipe now. And this is the finished product. This is what they look like before we let them, put them in a warm spot and let them rise again. I'm going to be checking this stewing potatoes and meat just to make sure I've got enough moisture. I still want about a half an inch to an inch of water at the bottom of the pan. And the chicken and the potatoes are tender now to a good doneness. And the next step will be to add the dumplings on top of the steam. And we're going to be taking the dumplings one by one, and you've got to be kind of careful when you're handling these so they don't fall. They fall very quickly if you don't handle them very gently. And you're going to be placing them on top of the potatoes. It's best to place them wherever you see a little bit of the moisture bubbling through. And you're going to give them a little bit of room to expand here. So you don't want to put them right next to each other, but leave about a half an inch to an inch space between all portions of the dumpling. And as you can see, it's at a pretty good rolling boil there, and that's how we want it. I might turn it down just a little bit once I get these placed. I have now put the lid on, and we have to let this whole mixture steam now for about 25 minutes on low to medium heat. Just keep the boiling kind of going, or the simmering going, throughout the whole process. And we cannot lift the cover during this time. If you lift the cover, the dumplings will totally fall and go flat. So you got to be really careful so that this process goes for the full 25 minutes without lifting the cover at all. I'm going to be checking this, lifting the cover. They look like the right doneness here. And I will be taking this over and getting these ready for serving. Good, I'll set this aside. And this is what the dumplings look like when they're done. Any kind of meat can be used for this dish. It can be pork, it can be pieces of beef. Pork chops work just fine. Sausage works also wonderfully. Sometimes you can cook this down a little bit more so that it can fry a little bit on the bottom. Occasionally Mom would take the chicken out of the roaster and put the potatoes and the dumplings back into the pan together to kind of give the dumplings some of the juice flavors from the bottom of the pan, and that was always very good. This is the finished product, chicken and dumplings, or Schupfnoodla.
Communal activities are important in small towns, whether it be a church supper, attendance at a high school sporting event, or a special meal at the local cafe.
Good morning, Hick Fay. Yavi Gates at Maria. She was wondering if we're having strudel today. My name is Helen Fisher. I do mostly the German dishes. I do the strudel, and I do the bean soup, and the blachenda, and the fry bread. And Fridays, we do cheese buns. I'm making strudel, though, and I'm making a big batch today. I used about 22 cups of flour. I'll get about 70 servings. I start the dough about, between 7:30 and 8 o'clock. Most of the local people come, and we have people from surrounding areas, even Bismarck. They come down with their motorcycles, quite a few of them, just about every Thursday. I get teased, I have my hands in the dough all the time. Well, I guess the dough is done. Yeah, it's just about ready. So we let it rise for about an hour, and then we roll it out.
Not a very big town of 100 people, a little less maybe. We've got good people here. We have a nice church, which helps a lot. The Hay Cafe is owned by the city of Hay, and the supermarket across the street is owned by the surrounding community. The people that were in them were selling, and they couldn't get a buyer, so the city bought the cafe, and the same thing happened at the store. They're a big asset to our little town. We need it real bad, and I hope that it stays as it is. It's where we get together twice a day. We have coffee at 10:30 in the morning, and at 3:30 in the afternoon, we usually get together. It's men and women both. There's no prejudice here. We're all together.
It's really going good today. Of all the days, I don't want to flop today. This one piece will make about 5 meals. The hole doesn't make any difference because I roll it up and nobody knows that it was there. Because they're all different sizes and shape. I make about, on the average, 50 to 60 dinners, and sometimes we run out, but I don't like to run out because it's just hard to tell people that we don't have no more strudel. Then they tell you, oh, we came from such and such a place and we really wanted some. We feel so bad when this happens. Yes, it's nice and warm up there, so they raise nice. A few weeks ago, we went to Arizona, and I had a brother in the hospital, and we made strudel and brought it to the hospital for him. We had a German group in here on Tuesday. They were in Strasbourg performing at the church, and they came in here for German food. Lachenda and fry bread and bean soup. Some didn't have any idea of what they're gonna get, but they liked it. Lenore Heimbach, she taught me how to make the strudel. I don't know if she had the holes in it. But I'm sure she did. Now we heat this up. Just keep it warm, that's all we need, have to do with that one. That makes about 170 today. Everyone gets 4. This evening, the Strasbourg Lions Club is having their dinner meeting in the Hague Café. So I will be fixing their meal. My daughter worked in here and she couldn't make it one day. She said, Mom, why don't you go and work for me? And that's how I got in here.
Ingredients for family-sized portions for Helen's strudel dish can be found in the companion recipe booklet. Recipes from Grandma's Kitchen will return with recipes for a wonderful Kuchen and a very special Christmas tea ring. But first, please take this opportunity to support Prairie Public Television and programs like Recipes from Grandma's Kitchen. Erica Wangler isn't the only one in her family who uses food traditions to stay connected with her heritage. Her sister Bernadine also knows her way around the kitchen. And next, Bernadine will demonstrate how to prepare a real Germans from Russia favorite, Kuchen.
Hello, I'm Bernadine Lang Kuhn from Owatonna, Minnesota, originally from Napoleon, North Dakota, and I am going to be demonstrating how to bake Germans from Russia recipe Kuchen. We'll get started with 2 cups of quite warm tap water, and then I will add the quick rising active yeast, and then I need to add 1/4 cup of sugar, and then I'll mix a little bit again, and then I need to add 1 teaspoon of salt. And then we'll mix again. Now we need to add 2 cups of flour. And then I will be mixing again and mix it up really quite well. And I learned this recipe from my mother. She made very good prune kuchen. Okay, next ingredient is 3 eggs. And 1/3 cup of lard. Now I like using pork lard. My mother used goose lard because they raised geese, and so they had it readily available. In the fall, we would pluck the geese and render the lard, and she would use that, which was very good. Okay, the next ingredient is another 1/2 cup of sugar. and 2 tablespoons of lemon flavoring. And the lemon is a special ingredient. It gives the dough a special flavor, and it's kind of like a secret ingredient in the dough making process. All right, now we'll continue by adding 4.5 cups of flour and mix a little, and then I'll add a little more just to see the consistency of the dough and add some more flour. The dough needs to be just a little sticky. Now I'm going to put the dough into this well-greased Tupperware bowl. I've been making it for a good 10 years or more. I've always watched my mother, but never really got serious until I noticed her health was failing. So I said, wow, I think it's time that I learn how to make this Germans from Russia delicacy. Round it out here. And then we're going to put it in the oven to rise. And that'll take about 45 minutes to an hour. A little hint is I usually preheat the oven at about 150 degrees for about a couple of minutes. And then I shut it off, and that'll be the right temperature for the whole process. The reason I use Watkins products is because I grew up in a rural area in the country, and a long ways from town, and there used to be salesmen that would canvass the area. They would sell you all their products, and one of them that frequently stopped by me about every 6 weeks would be the Watkins salesperson. And my mother would purchase the vanilla and the lemon and maybe the cinnamon, and that's maybe why I use those products the most, because those are the ones that she enjoyed using. While the dough is rising, I have all these other little things I get accomplished, and I make the custard for the Kuchen, and I beat 6 eggs, and then I add 1 1/4 cup of heavy whipping cream, and make sure it is heavy whipping cream so it is has a nice consistency, it's nice and thick, and add about 1/4 teaspoon salt. And we need to get the vanilla. Add about a couple of tablespoons of Watkins vanilla. And then you need to put it on the stove to cook very slowly. And it either should be done in a double boiler or in a kettle that is has a firm base to it, so it doesn't cook too fast and get curdled. So you cook this very slow over a medium heat, constantly stirring so you don't get the curdled. And it should be cooked to a kind of a syrupy consistency. Another project that I do while I'm waiting for the dough to rise is get my Kuchen pans ready. And my Kuchen pans are 9-inch layer pans. And usually the recipe makes anywhere from 8 to 9 Kuchens. And what I do is I take, again, my pork lard, and I spread it around the pan. So when the pans are greased generally, then you can just kind of set them aside. And I set them on the stove because usually the stove is kind of a warmer area where the dough is rising, and then this lard will stay liquefied. Okay, now we're ready for the next step. We're going to roll out the Kuchen dough into these 9-inch cake layer pan, and I'm going to start out with sprinkling some flour on here. It does not stick to the counter. You can tell it has a nice consistency. I take a piece of dough that I will consider would be the right size for the pan, and I kind of just pat a little bit, turn it around, and get my rolling pin. The dough has a lot of elasticity, so it's really quite flexible. And I put it in the pan and shape it up, flip it around. Then it needs to rise again. It needs to rise for approximately 20 minutes to a half an hour. Okay, now the rolling process is completed. And now our Kuchen dough is ready to apply the fruit. And I'm going to apply prune for the first one. And I take prunes and I stew them approximately a half an hour on top of the stove and cool them down. and drain them quite well. And then I take each one and kind of pull them apart and apply them on the Kuchen dough with the skin part down and the meaty part to the top. I like to outline the pan quite close to the edge also, and that kind of helps the custard to stay in place. Okay, the prune one is completed, and now I will do the cherry one. The flavors of Kuchen can be quite various. You can do peach, and when I do peach, I also like to buy canned peach slices. I drain them really well, and then I also buy peach pie filling. And I arrange the peach slices around in a circle, and then I add a little peach pie filling, and it just gives it a lot more flavor. And I do the same way with apricot. Apple is very good. Also, I experimented with one not too long ago. I bought some cottage cheese, tried to drain some of the liquid off of it and arranged it on my Kuchen pastry. And then I took a can of crushed pineapple, drained that really well, spread that on top of the cottage cheese, and it was quite tasty. And my next one will be an onion. Sometimes they wouldn't have enough fruit around, especially in the Dakotas and so on. And they would take any type of vegetable they grew in the garden. And I'm sure some gal ran out of fruit one day, so she decided to peel an onion and slice it very thinly, arrange it on top of the pastry dough, and really is quite tasty. Doesn't maybe sound like it's tasty, but it really is. Okay, and this is the last step in the process, and here's this custard, and I put that on the stove to get this syrupy consistency. And you take this custard and drizzle it around on the top of the fruit toppings. And the reason you like to make it a syrupy consistency because it just sets up a little quicker when you're baking it. And the next step is to take a sprinkle of sugar on top. If you don't like it quite as sweet or watching calories, and maybe you could even cut this process out if you like. And maybe the onion, you might want to just be a little more generous again with the sugar. The baking process will take the onion flavor out, and you'd be quite surprised at the taste. Okay, the last step is to give it a little sprinkle of cinnamon, and then we are ready for the oven. I generally put three kuchens in the oven, whatever my oven holds, and then I bake it at 425 degrees. Make sure the oven is preheated to 425, and it's approximately 20 minutes for all three. But you can check and see, and open up the oven and just give it a little gentle shake, and if the custard is set and the crust is a nice golden brown, it should be ready to come out. This is the peach. This is the apricot. This is the apple for another flavor. And this is the one that I told you about, the cottage cheese and the pineapple. And this is the finished product. My favorite is prune, because I guess that's maybe the first one I ate as a child. So my favorite is still prune.
For most of her life, Alma Schott has enjoyed cooking, baking, and making special treats. Her tea ring is a Christmas favorite, but it's also appropriate for any holiday or just about any time when you'd like to impress your friends or family.
I'm Alma Schott from Gackle, North Dakota. I'm making a sweet dough for my Christmas tea ring. And first of all, I put my warm water in the bowl. And then I add my sugar, a half a cup of sugar, and then I'll put my yeast in with that. I put 2.5 tablespoons of yeast with the sugar and the water, and then I will add 1.5 teaspoons of salt, and then I will mix these ingredients. And I let them sit for a little, maybe 5 minutes, just till the yeast is softened enough to come to the top. In the meanwhile, I will beat up my 4 eggs. And 1/2 cup of oil. I beat those two together. Okay, now we will put this all together. And I will start adding the flour, which I might have, usually use about 9 cups of flour to get a nice spongy dough. I have my flour all measured out, so I'll just keep on mixing with the beater until it's so I can't, I'll have to go in with my hands to knead the rest of the dough. My mother used to tell me, when you work with dough, the more you beat it, the better it rises. And I found that out. If you knead it a lot, it raises so nicely. This is such, so much fun. There. We'll see what happens now. Boy, that's kind of work that you kind of get a little warm. Now I better go in with my hands. Now that works better now. It's already rising, fast rising yeast I use. There, I think I've got it. Just to knead the flour real good into the dough. I remember making strudels one time, and I made the dough with the flour. I didn't get all the flour into the dough. And my mother said, well, this is not the way I do it. You got to work that flour in all the way to the dough. So I guess I learned to do that. Boy, look at my hands. Got more dough on my fingers yet, but we'll get it. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to put a little bit of oil around my dough, around the bowl, so it doesn't stick to my bowl. And then we're ready to let it rise. We'll let it rise so it's a double in bulk. I'm going to knead my dough, the T-ring dough, and then I will bring it out. Okay, I'm going to bring about 1/2 of the dough. Got to work a little bit with it yet. Oh, this is nice. Now we'll work it for a while. Okay, now I think I'm ready to roll it out. Oh, yummer. This is bubbly. Sticky. Bisschen. There. Now we'll roll this out. We'll make this a little bit bigger now. So we gotta make it a little bit longer one way than the other. So we can have a nice roll. Oh yeah, that's so nice and spongy. Okay, I think that's good. Now what I'm gonna do, I'm going to spread butter on this dough. Next, we will put my brown sugar on it. Boy, my fingers, they get a lot of taste of all this good flavoring. This is cinnamon. I put the cardamom on first. We'll add the raisins. Sometimes I soak the raisins so they get a little more pulpy. Now, okay. And a little more. And we bring this over. Try to get it to stay on the other side here. Okay, what I'm gonna do, I'll try to put the seam on the bottom. What I'm doing,
I'm pinching these ends together, so it's all in one roll. And I cut my individually like this. I'm making the rolls now. I cut this all in one. What I do, I lay one roll this way, one way, and the other one the out towards the outside. And that's the way I keep on going till they're all used up. And I usually let it raise until it's double in size. And I'm gonna put my T-rings in the oven now at 350 degrees. And I'll need to bake them about 30 minutes for them to get done. So they're nice and brown on top. After it's baked, I usually decorate this part as a wreath. I put a bow on it. I do it with icing or I do real ribbon. And I decorate my roll after that. I am going to mix my icing for glaze on this roll. And then I will add a little bit of lemon juice or lime. It does, either one you could, can be used. And I usually like to let it run down to the sides a little bit. Okay, we're getting up to this part where we're going to finish it off with, so it looks like a wreath. But first of all, I'm going to do the cherries on it. So it looks real Christmassy. So we got a little bit of Christmas, the fruit and the nuts, and here. There's our Christmas ring.
We hope you've enjoyed Recipes from Grandma's Kitchen. And we'd like to thank all of our special chefs who made this program possible. And of course, all the Germans from Russia grandmas that have handed down those culinary memories that feed the soul and warm the heart.